morning and a very warm welcome to our service from St Peter's Church in Woolton on this, the first Sunday in Lent. My name is Julia Pratt and I serve as the curate here at St Peter's. Now, throughout Lent, we're going to be hearing about some encounters of Jesus. Some of the gospel accounts which tell us of the people whom Jesus met throughout his ministry, his time here on earth. We're going to be hearing what he said to these people, how he interacted with these people, and how they responded to him. Today we're going to hear about the time when Jesus met with some teachers of the law in the temple at Jerusalem. Well, you know, as we come to worship, we meet with Jesus. So let us take a moment of quiet as we prepare ourselves to pray with him, to worship him, and to let him speak to us. Lord Jesus, our loving Saviour, as we come before you, we know that we are sinners. We can look back on the times when we have behaved in ways that we know to be wrong. We can look back on the times when our words have been hurtful or rude. We can look back on the times when our thoughts have not been pure and good. Lord Jesus, our loving Saviour, as we come before you, we know that you are love. And we thank you for that love which took you to the cross, by which we are forgiven. Renew us, Lord Jesus, we pray, and transform us by the great power of your Holy Spirit within us. Amen. Well, as forgiven people, we now sing our Lord's praises.
History. Today's reading is from Luke chapter 2, reading from verse 41. The boy Jesus at the temple. Every year his parents went to Jerusalem for the feast of the Passover. When he was 12 years old, they went up to the feast according to the custom. After the feast was over, while his parents were returning home, the boy Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem, but they were unaware of it. Thinking he was in their company, they travelled on for a day. Then they began looking for him among their relatives and friends. When they did not find him, they went back to Jerusalem to look for him. After 3 days, they found him in the temple courts, sitting among the teachers, listening to them and asking them questions. Everyone who heard him was amazed at his understanding and his answers. When his parents saw him, they were astonished. His mother said to him, "Son, why have you treated us like this? Your father and I have been anxiously searching for you." "Why were you searching for me?" he asked. "Didn't you know I had to be in my father's house?" But they did not understand what he was saying to them. Then he went down to Nazareth with them and was obedient to them. But his mother treasured all these things in her heart. And Jesus grew in wisdom and stature and in favour with God and men. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Hello, I'm going to begin with a prayer by a boy, Samuel, in the Bible. Just very simple. Lord, speak, for your servants are listening. Amen. When I say in this talk together, I wonder if you would do that. Let's try it together. Don't have to do it, but it's just if you want to. So let me begin with a story. Sunday school teacher or leader has been speaking about David and Goliath and then asked the children, "What do we learn from David and Goliath?" And one child puts their hand up, "To duck!" Well, you might not find it funny. But anyway, what I want to say, children, we're really glad, I'm really glad that you're here, because you show us things we haven't seen before and you bring a freshness to all our life together. So thank you. The Bible story is about Jesus as a child, and children, that's really important because Jesus has been a child. He's been a teenager. He understands what life is like for you as a child and as a teenager. It's rather like Jesus singing to you, "You've got a friend in me," like Woody in Toy Story. Now, Bishop Martin, next St. Peter's, have a great motto. Get ready. Learning together in God's love. And that's a really good title for today's reading, for it gives us a model about three things. Here we go. Learning together as family, learning together as church, and learning together with Jesus. And the result of this learning together comes at the end of the reading. It's that Jesus grew in wisdom and stature, in favour with God and people. And that's what Jesus wants for us all ages, so that we learn from the stories in the Bible and all that's written in the Bible to become more like Jesus. So let's move to the first one as we look at Mary and Joseph and Jesus, and we learn together as family. Let's imagine the time. It was festival time. Everyone was having some fun. They were drinking. They were eating. They were singing. You got a friend in me. They were having such a good time. And they were big families together and everything. And then suddenly, where's Jesus? Do you know where Jesus is? I can't find Jesus. Is he there? No. Is he there? No. We've lost Jesus. And they search everywhere. They go down the streets, the alleys, the homes. Well, eventually, where do they find him? They find him in the temple. They are so relieved. And they're back together. I think the parents would have been a bit cross. Jesus, he gets a telling off. Have you ever been told off? Jesus understands. Parents, have you ever told your children off? Jesus understands. I think Jesus probably learned a lesson, and it was probably a lesson he had to learn over and over again. Jesus, tell us where you're going and who you're with when you go off like that. But Joseph and Mary also learned something very important. I think when they came into the temple and they saw Jesus, I think they would have stopped for a moment, because they were the ones who shared the story that then got written down. They saw that he sat, he listened, he asked, he understood and answered about God and how we're to live. Mary and Joseph and Jesus learned together as a family. And I feel with all my heart that God is calling families to learn together. How can you do that? Well, you're doing it at this very moment as you watch the service online. And maybe as you sing the songs, you join in the prayers, you join in the actions. Certainly when our children were young and we were reading stories at bedtime, we would include a Bible story. And this Bible story, this book of children's Bible has very short stories, and we would read those and say a prayer afterwards about something that we liked from the story or jumped out from the story. And then we would pray for each other and for family and friends and for people in need. But it may be that with you have children who are preschool and worship through plays, absolutely brilliant for that. But also, if you go on the website, you'll find there's much about the Show Love campaign for caring for God's wonderful world that we love so much. And there are things you can do as a family. Well, second, we look at Jesus with those older than him in the temple, and we're learning about learning together as church. In the story, we see that church is not just for adults, but it's for all ages. So at St. Peter's, we welcome children. We plan fun activities. We help them to grow in faith and partner families in that. And it's a time, of course, when children and adults do things separately, but there's also a time for us doing together as children learn from adults and adults learn from children. And that's why it was so good to have youth and children helping with the Advent Bible readings and with the latest Bible readings. Samuel and Emily Grace Beaumont were absolutely great, as were Henry and Charles Ellams. And then how brilliant to have youth. Say there was Anna McArdle, and we've had even older youth, Anna Robinson, sharing last Sunday. We're learning together as church. So I do encourage you, children and adults, do pray for Lorraine as she heads up our children and youth work at this very difficult time. and for the team of volunteers. And if you're a volunteer who's not active, I really encourage you at this time to grow your relationship with God. Look at the things that are on offer about learning to read the Bible, to encourage your prayer and pray for the work and encourage the work. Why not send a text or an email to Lorraine? But also, I say the same things about Ruth Fletcher and her team with Worship Through Play. There's a lovely African saying, it takes a village to bring up a child. And it's the same with church. Church, it takes the whole church to nurture children's faith. Now, Jesus was single all his life. And it reminds me that families and those of us who are single, we're all working together to nurture everyone's faith. I believe God is calling us to learn together as church. I'm nearly there. Finally, learning together with Jesus. This is you and Jesus together. Listen to the actions that Jesus did in the temple. Jesus sat with them. Jesus listened to them. Jesus asked questions. Jesus understood. Jesus answered. Now imagine you and Jesus together. I encourage you to have your Bible. And then it's you and Jesus. He sits with you when you found a space and a time to do so. He knows all about you. He understands. Share with him just how it is at this time. And as you read from the Bible, let it speak into your very precious life. Juliet last week spoke about experiencing God's presence as a very special time. And Mary in the Bible passage treasured up what had happened with Jesus in her heart. As we learn together as family, as we learn together as church, as we learn together with Jesus, we'll find Jesus meeting us wherever we are, whatever our age, and speaking words of comfort and guidance and promise and hope. And every now and again, we'll experience Jesus' presence with us, or we'll just know Jesus is with us. And we'll find, like Mary, things to treasure. And then we'll be learning together in God's love.
I wonder if we could pray in a different way this morning. And perhaps some of us might like to draw around our hand to help us pray during the week ahead. And possibly, if you enjoy getting messy, you might like to add some painted fingerprints. The fingerprints remind us that we are all different, but God knows and loves each one of us. Let us pray. Looking at the palm of our hand, let's thank God for the world. Lord, we thank you for the wonderful world you have created. Help us to know how we can look after your world. Help us to more fairly share our resources and to find more ways in which we can help the environment. Thank you that so many of us were able to think about fair trade initiatives this week when we made our pancakes. Holding our thumb, think of a country in the world that is struggling at the moment. Lord, we think of areas of the world that have been hit by disaster, for the areas ravaged by war, for the areas damaged by earthquakes and other natural disasters. Lord, be with those countries experiencing political unrest and turmoil at the moment. We pray that you will bring your love and your peace. Holding our second finger, Lord, we pray for our own country. We thank you for our Queen and the royal family. We ask you to give wisdom to our leaders and for those in authority. Please help them to work together to find a way out of this pandemic. Holding our third finger, Lord, we pray for the church, both nationally and locally. We ask you to be with our bishops and especially our clergy and staff here at St. Peter's. Be with Kip and Julia, with Lorraine, Jen and Derek, as they work so hard in our community. Holding our fourth finger, we pray for our city of Liverpool and for our own community here in Woolton. We thank you for our own homes and for those comforts we so often take for granted. And we thank you for the love and support of our families and friends. We thank you for our church family, and we pray that you will be close to those we know who are unwell, both at home and in hospital, and for those who are feeling lonely and vulnerable at the moment. We ask you to comfort those who are suffering the loss of a loved family member or friend. And then holding our little finger, thank you, Lord, that you love each one of us. Thank you that you are always with us. And we pray that you will show us little ways that we can make a difference to your world. Open our eyes to the needs of those around us and help us to show them your love. Amen. Together, let's pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Crowd and send my praise to heaven. I will run this race and
Thank you for joining us today. After our blessing this morning, there will be two things that I would encourage you to stay around for. Firstly, the group of us in St. Peter's who meet to pray about and discuss ideas to help us all to read the Bible more have decided to share with everyone over the coming weeks, in 30 seconds, some different ways to read or engage with the Bible for free. So today, can I encourage you to stay around just for 30 seconds if you can't manage any more, and to do so for the coming weeks as well. And you never know, you might hear something and you say, do you know what? That's the idea for me. And then after that 30-second slot today, Dot Baker, who is one of our readers, will be looking a little bit more at our Bible reading in a sermon which is aimed at adults. But as I said last week, children and young people, you are welcome to stay with us as well. But before our blessing, I have a couple of notices to give out. You may remember that Laura shared with us last week about how we can help to care for God's world. Well, last week, quite a number of children from our church gathered together on Zoom for an eco-themed party. And during that party, they made some amazing crafts and also some creations out of products that were going for recycling. And some of these artistic creations are now displayed in the windows of the Simon Peter Centre. So can I encourage you on your daily walk to walk past and just see some of those wonderful creations that the children have made. And something else that has happened since last week's service is that our newly formed Eco Youth Group have met for the first time. And they're going to be sharing some of their ideas with us next week. So that is really something to look forward to. And you know, we've heard today of the Jewish teachers being amazed and inspired by the boy Jesus. Well, maybe today, challenged by our children and our young people, in this season of Lent, we might want to think about something we could give up that would help to protect God's beautiful world. Or maybe there might be something which we could take on. The second notice is that you may have seen photos of our church family sharing their fair trade pancakes following Shrove Tuesday last week. And as we head into Fair Trade Fortnight, which begins on the 22nd of February. And as we celebrate as a church that we are now registered as a fair trade church, we're encouraging everybody, lots of all ages, to design a fair trade poster. And that will go onto our Simon Peter window display. And there's an incentive to enter a fair trade poster, because there will be a fair trade Easter egg for the winning entry. I don't know who's judging, but if I win the Easter egg, you know that the judging's gone wrong. But if you want more information about that, then that will be on our website. So let's just take a moment of quiet as we then come to ask for God's blessing upon ourselves today. May God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who is the source of all goodness and growth, pour his blessing upon all things created and upon us, his children, that we may use his gifts to his glory and for the welfare of all peoples. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with each one of us today and always. Amen.
YouVersion is a Bible app available on the App Store or Google Play. The app offers access to different Bible versions, a verse for the day, audio Bibles, prayer journaling, and Bible plans. The plans offer short daily readings on specific topics or sections of the Bible for you to read on your own or together with friends who have the app. Such an easy way to connect with God and others each day. I love it. Within the app, there is also a short, simple daily devotion and prayer suitable for an older primary school child for you to read together. And for the younger child, there is a YouVersion Bible app just for them with great animations and interactive learning. I would highly recommend this app, and it's free, so why not give it a try?
Good morning. It's often said that life is a journey. It's a term used quite freely in the media now. Every contestant on a dancing, skating, or singing show during their being voted off speech will thank people for the journey they have travelled during their time on that show. We speak of our faith journey, which begins the moment we accept Jesus as Lord and ends the day we enter glory to be by his side forever. Now, we may not travel geographically very far on that journey, but spiritually we travel miles and miles of smooth paths rocky roads, valleys of despair, and mountaintops of pure joy and forgiveness. Our Bibles are full of God's people journeying. Sometimes their journey is obviously God's clear intention for them, but sometimes when life deals them a bitter blow, then like a heavenly sat-nav, God travels that journey with them. He works within their exile to bring them back to their spiritual home. Abraham, called by God when he was well on in years, was called to leave his home at Ur and travel some 1,500 miles across present-day Syria, Iraq, and Egypt to Canaan, a journey not just for him, but his wife, his family, his servants, and his flocks, a journey with many pitfalls, but ultimately with the blessing, even in their old age, of children and grandchildren, indeed the very birth of the nation of Israel. Joseph, of the amazing coat, journeyed from Canaan to Egypt, not by choice, but as a result of his jealous, unloving brothers selling him into slavery. A journey that, travelling alone, could have ended in disaster for Joseph. But God travelled with him, and after many years of struggling with rough terrain, saw him become ruler of Egypt and Pharaoh's right-hand man. Moses' life journey, understandably made into many action-packed blockbuster movies, recounts his journey from a baby escaping a massacre by being hidden in the bulrushes by his mother, to Prince of Egypt, to a murderer living the life of a fugitive in the wilderness, to the chosen one, chosen to lead God's people out of slavery in Egypt to freedom in the Promised Land. An Exodus journey that geographically should have taken about 11 days, but actually took over 40 years. And why was that? Because these journeys are not just physical journeys, but emotional, faith-building, God-discovering journeys. Journeys during which our heroes are not just sightseeing to a destination, but are learning to draw closer and to rely on God. Journeys in which they travel from naivety to wisdom, from self-centeredness to maturity, to betrayal, from betrayal to reconciliation. Journeys in which they need to grow in faith, grace, wisdom, and love, and come to understand that they need to live in harmony with an alien culture to show that they are truly set apart for God. So what about Mary and Joseph on their journey, which we heard about today? Had Mary and Joseph not learned or travelled enough already? Joseph had to face a crisis of faith when he learned his fiancée was pregnant with another man's child. Mary then faced the arduous journey to Bethlehem to give birth to that child. Then they needed to travel to Egypt to become refugees in a foreign land to escape the murderous King Herod, before finally they could journey back to Nazareth with their child. Then there's a journey that all new parents face as we struggle to raise our first child. And yet they are now facing another journey as they travel on pilgrimage with the able people from the village to Jerusalem, a journey of maybe 5 days and nights to celebrate Passover. And this is the only account we have in our Bibles of Jesus as a child. Our Bibles tell us that when the feast days were over, they all started for home, the whole village travelling together for safety, for fear of attack from bandits on the way. Mary must have believed that Jesus, as he was almost grown, had travelled with the men of the group. And Joseph presumed that his youngest son was with his mother and some of the other women. They travelled all day, and when evening came and they started to set up camp for the night, they made the grim discovery that Jesus was not with either of them, nor was he with any other relatives or friends. In fact, Jesus was nowhere to be found. So they returned to Jerusalem to find him. After a three-day frantic search, they find him in the temple at Jerusalem, sitting among the teachers, listening to them and asking questions. Mary, his mother, said something like, "Child, why have you treated us like this? Your father and I have been very worried as we search for you." To which Jesus replies, "Why were you searching? Or why couldn't you find me? Didn't you know that I must be in my Father's house?" The young Jesus was not lost. He was in his heavenly Father's home. He was identifying himself as the Son of God, and his home was where his Father is. Our Bibles tell us that Mary and Joseph didn't really understand this, but Jesus then obediently travelled back to Nazareth with them, and Mary treasured this day in her heart. This account of the journey of Mary and Joseph searching for Jesus is an invitation for us to consider our faith journey and where we are along that route. At some tough times, we may think ourselves parted from God as we frantically search for Jesus. The good news is that Jesus is exactly where he is supposed to be, just waiting for us to find him. We may find ourselves missing God's presence in our lives, searching for him in all the wrong places. We use our knowledge to search for him where it is most convenient or most fitting. Just like the wise men, they searched for him in a palace and were surprised to find him in the carpenter's home. Mary and Joseph were searching for Jesus in all the wrong places. Jesus wasn't lost, but Mary and Joseph were lost without him. Mary and Joseph were travelling away from the temple, while Jesus never left the temple. They were travelling away from God. Jesus was staying close to God, where he was supposed to be. When we find ourselves separated from God, remember, God has not moved. He is the same unchanging God, yesterday, today, and forever. When life takes us away from him, we just need to stop, to change direction and return to him, where he is waiting to welcome us home. And if God calls us to journey for him, we can be sure that not only has he gone ahead to prepare a way for us, but that he also walks every step of that journey with us. We can all lose sight of Jesus at some time in our Christian journey if we don't watch out carefully. The challenge is for us to keep our eyes fixed on Jesus day by day. John Pritchard, former Bishop of Oxford, said, "The reality is that most of us at some stage in our Christian journey enter a grey period when the vivid awareness that God used to shine and delight us has disappeared. What was once bright and shiny is now tarnished and grey. The good news is that when we learn from our biblical ancestors, it is never too late to turn back to where we last saw Jesus, to retrace our steps and to find him again exactly where we left him, to be forgiven and to restart our journey afresh. And as history reveals to each one of us, that we are truly blessed by our encounter with Jesus, as were the teachers in the temple with the boy Jesus." When Jesus affirmed Peter in his ministry after Peter had denied him three times, Jesus didn't ask why he had denied him or why he had run away. Jesus asked Peter, "Do you love me?" Because that is where our journey begins. Let us pray. Lord, whether our present journey is taking us over rough terrain or smooth pastures, we know you are with us every step of the way. And if we lose sight of you, give us the courage to stop and to retrace our steps to find you again. Amen.